Namaste. Welcome to yet another interesting conversation in Atharva Forum. And today we are going to converse about a very interesting topic, Church's sinister role in the social history of South India. Tamil Nadu has always been at the forefront, or it has been the apple's eye of evangelical forces and Christian missionaries who have had their presence in that state for nearly more than 500 years, and they have had a very prominent role in creating the narrative, be it in the Tamil Hindu cultural narrative, by creating fault lines and exploiting them for their own benefits. And as a result, we have a fractured society today. Their involvement ranges a whole spectrum from redefining the societal norms, to influencing the polity, to redefining the historical narratives, as well as the appropriation and inculturation of the art forms of Tamil Nadu particular and South India in general. To talk on these lines, today we have with us a well-known, well-reputed epigraphist, Mr. S. Ramachandran, who has been associated with the Tamil Nadu State Archaeology Department for more than 3 decades. And even after his retirement, he continues to research, to interact, to present on topics which are concerned about Tamil history, Tamil Nadu's history, the history of several communities in Tamil Nadu. Welcome, Ramachandran ji, to this forum. And let me begin by asking one of the first question, which is quite recent, that has created a storm both in the media as well as social media and in the society. This is about attack on Bhagwan Murugan by the Karuppar Koottam. So in the recent wake of the attack on Bhagwan Murugan by the Karuppar Koottam, you highlighted the equivalence between Aham Brahmasmi and Subramanya. And in the same presentation, you had also said how Bhagwan Rama is as much indigenous to Tamil as Murugan. So let's begin this conversation by you elaborating on this point for the benefit of our audience. Ramachandran ji.
Thank you, sir. Muruga worship, as actually among the 6 religious sects, Shanmata, Kaumaram is the sect which concerns with the worship of Muruga. That means Muruga is an individual deity, not only deity, it has absolute godhead. All 6 are equal. Gradually, Shaiva and Vaishnava, Shaivism and Vaishnavism might have become the two most prominent religious sects, but that doesn't mean that all other sects, 4 other sects, are subordinate to this. Subramanya Muruga is also supreme godhead. There's no doubt in it. For example, I will tell you the real word for Muruga is in Tamil is Seyon or Sevved, the red god. It is equal to Rudra. That's why I think, according to my viewpoint, the word Shiva is actually a Tamil word, because Shivappu in Tamil means not only red, Semmai means anything which is good, which is auspicious, which is noble. That's why we call Tamil as Sendamil, righteous rule as Sengol. Even the very word Semmai means good, auspicious. So the word Shiva, which forms part of the Panchakshara, Namas Shivaya cha Sivataraya cha, the word itself might have gone from Tamil, because it has got 2 meanings. One is color red, that is Rudra's color, and another is auspicious. So Muruga is not actually, he might have become the son of Shiva. That's a different process. In every religious sect or history, religious history, we have such assimilations, absorptions, and mingling of cults. So that's a different matter. But Subramanya cult, Muruga cult is, it's not subordinate. It was not subordinate to any cult. It was an absolute godhead. Muruga was an absolute godhead. So the in Sangam literature, the earliest literature in Tamil, we have got many references about Muruga. Primary form of Muruga worship is tribal. Yes, Muruga, the Kaumara itself, the word in Tulu, Kumare means trance. One who goes into a trance and one who receives the Godhead inside him. In Tamil, it is called Muruhatru Paduthal. Muruhatru Paduthal means bringing Muruga inside the body. That is the Bhakta himself transforming into the Godhead. Both Bhakta and the Godhead mingle together and they transform into the deity. That is called, that is considered as Muruhatru Paduthal in Tamil. So, Muruhatru Padai was one of the Sangam classics. Apart from that, it has been included in the 12 Saiva Thirumurais, that is Saiva canons in later period. They were classified as 12. Thirumuruhatru Padai also has been included in that because they understood that Muruga was another form of Shiva. So, this Subramanya, which means Subramanya, one who has become Brahma Swarupa. This concept is very similar to the tribal concept of a trance. That going to a trance may sound tribal, but at the same time, there is the main point that the Godhead and the Bhakta, for the time being, they have become one. So in Thirumuruhatru Padai, though it starts as a showing the way to the Bhakta, to Godhead, Muruga's abodes, wherever Muruga resides, islands inside the Kandu. Kandu means a Shivalinga. Muruga resides in the Kandu or Linga, in the form of Linga, and he is the lord of Kurinji or mountainous tract. In many shapes and many forms, he becomes incarnate. But at the same time, the Muruhatru Padai starts like this, but gradually it enters into another type of song, that is lyric. After the line 220 or 230, it gradually enters into this field, that is the Bhakta, the devotee. He is going there, he is going to all the abodes and worshipping and observing all the types of worships conducted in various manners, and the Godhead appears before him. This lyric, the verse says, Manangamal Deivathu Ilanalam Kaatti Anjal Ombumadi Arival Nin Varavana Thondruvan. Anjal Ombumadi means the Muruga appears before him, consoles him, don't be fearful, don't be afraid, I have come in presence of you. And then he gives a gift as a noble lord or a chieftain or a king. The Muruga, he gives a major gift to the devotee in the form of, that is the main point in that verse, that is Uru niyaga thondra peralarum perisil villumiya peralarim parisil nalgumadi. The deity Muruga will give you a major gift. It will be, after that, after receiving the gift, you will become one with the God, and you will be the only one in this world. That is similar to Advaita. That is, the Godhead has mingled with the devotee. Oru niyaga thondra vilumiya peralarum parisil nalgumadi. Parisil means a gift from the God. What was the gift? It is Brahma. Brahma upadesa, or absorbing the Bhakta devotee inside the God. That is what the verse tells us in the Thirumuruhatru Padai. Nakirar, the author, explicitly gives this instruction that the devotee becomes Godhead itself. So this is the basic concept which I want to insist, that Thirumuruhatru Padai is not like other similar Atru Padais are showing the path way to the pattern, to the craving devotee. It is not like that. Showing the path of mingling with the God Aham Brahmasmi. That is why I gave this point in, I inserted in that talk, that the main point of interest in this verse is Uru Niyaha Tondra Vilumiya Veralarum Parisil Nalgumadi. This is the end. Particularly, Tamil people who are well versed with Tamil grammar know that this madi is a suffix intended for second person only. Not that is, it is not intended for third person verb. Nalhumadi means you will give. But who will give? The devotee and God have become one. That is the main point. That's why I told in the gave that point in that lecture, that Aham Brahmasmi is the concept elaborated in this particular devotional verse, Thirumulattupadai.
In the same line, you also said that even Ramar is as much indigenous to Tamil Nadu as it is. But that is also quite contextual now.
Yes. The thing is, it was only a reply to that particular Catholic missionary, that he, in his talk, he said that Muruga may be an indigenous god because he is extolled in Sangam literature. But Rama is an Aryan hero or Aryan god. I replied in that for that question only, that problem only. Concerning Rama worship, I want to put a counter question to those people. Where Rama is considered as a hero, where Rama is cherished as a clan chief, where Rama is still considered as a as an ancestor of their house, their lineage. Cholas, in various prasastis in their inscriptions, they have talked about Rama, claiming Rama as their ancestors because they belong to the Surya Kula. Throughout the world, where Rama is considered as an ancestor, only in India. So how can we say that Rama is a migrant, or Rama is an invader, Rama is an alien? And particularly this Siddhar, Shivavakyar. Shivavakyar was a Siddhar, that is Siddha Purusha, who was not very soft on the idolaters, idol worshipping, because Nattakallai Devamandu Nalubushum Satya Sutti Vandu Munamanandu Sullamandra Medada. He was not an idolater. At the same time, he has extolled the Ramanama. Anti Santi Uchi Vele Adhindra Tirthamum, Tabangalum, Jabangalum, Yandai Rama, Rama Rama, Ramayanum, Namame. Siddhar Shivavakya, Siddha Purusha has extolled the name of Ramanama. So, branding Rama as an alien is clearly a missionary agenda to divide people on the basis of North, South, and Valmiki Ramayana. It is in Sanskrit. So Rama might have spoken Sanskrit. What are all these rubbish? Rama is considered as an ancestor of Cholas. So we are these people are trying to brand Cholas as also aliens. Let them do it, but they will be unmasked, certainly.
Wonderful. That's what I said. I mean, they create fault lines which are not existing, and then they exploit those fault lines further down to fracture the society. So people like you have beautifully answered that. Christian missionaries and evangelical forces are operating in Tamil Nadu for more than 500 years. And they have indeed succeeded in various missions. So, and they have replicated this model also throughout India. They have intervened into the social narrative. They have played into the history of the society. So very briefly, can you please throw light on these aspects?
Yes, they have captured the, especially Lutheran missionaries, Protestants captured the educational field, academic field. That has happened in the, connivance of British colonialists. And they were very strategic also. They were very diplomatic in their endeavor, because previously the Portuguese, who were Catholics, they brutally, they attacked temples and plundered. So they gradually, they became very unpopular. So these people, Protestant, these Britishers especially, where industrial revolution changed the face of the entire world. So they were very calculating and they were very experts. They had the expertise academic qualifications. For example, Robert Caldwell, though he was a bishop of the Protestant SPG society for the propagation of the gospel, he was such an expert that his work stands the scrutiny of scholars till today, that is after nearly 150 years. His comparative grammar of Dravidian languages, he was such a great linguist that we have to accept their scholarship. At the same time, they know how to enter their agenda into that academic curricula. For example, in the comparative grammar of Dravidian languages, though his approach is linguistic angle, he assuming that racial theory and the linguistic theory are same, race and language are one and same. He preaches that the Brahmins who were Aryans who came to India as immigrants or as invaders, they colonized, they civilized the people. This in superficially it will think that he is glorifying the Brahmins, but not so. He tries to instigate the people by saying that you are all barbarians, you still deserve that. So one angle. It's another angle is they were also white people. 3000 years back they came to civilize this land, but that time has passed, and now under the guard, that is with an aim of proselytizing, preaching the Protestant Christianity, we white people have come with modern science and modern education like this. So his agenda is clear. Mingling race and language together, clearly it can be disproved because many people, many racial mixtures have taken place in anthropologists have already talked about this. Modern genetic research, it clearly proves that there was a heavy intermingling of racial features in the every indigenous. So linguistic theory is different, racial theory, racial approach is different. These people, the missionary, due to their agenda, with an eye on their agenda, nearly 40 years back, I was working at Kuttalam as a curator in the Folk Arts Museum at Kuttalam. Kuttalam is extreme south, where there is a famous waterfalls. So that Kuttalam, it was an archaeological site museum. It was termed as Folk Arts Museum. In Tamil, it was translated as Nattu Pura Kalai Agalvaipagam. Agalvaipagam is an archaeological museum. Folk Arts was translated as Nattu Pura Kalai. But at the time, there was one Folk Arts section, department in Saviour's College, Palayankottai, Trinalveli. The name of the department was in Tamil, it was mentioned as Nattar Vazhakkatriyal Aayumaiyam. Vazhakkatriyal means usages, customs, traditions. And Nattar was the exact translation for folk. Actually, what this term Nattar connotes is not the sense of the term folk. Nattar means those people who belong to the soil. Nadu is country. Those people who own this country are called Nattar. But actually Nattu Puram will be the correct translation. But why they preferred this term, you know, to distinguish between Vetrar or foreigners. They are not Nattar. And in English, the foreigners or who are elites, they will be called as classics. Classic art and folk art. They will put this against that other. So their motive is very clear. They want to divide this society into classical and folk. Folk means Nattar who own the soil. Classical or elite people have come from other area and they are dominating the field. That is what they wanted to. At the time I had some conversation and even arguments with those people, but that's only kept in my memory. That's not a very significant thing. But I have personal experience why they insisted on the particular word Nattar. So there are many such efforts with an agenda in their mind. They have been doing all such things.
Thank you very much, Ramachandran ji, for that response and your personal experience also in that. although it's a very nuanced thing, you rightly said that even though they're scholars, they use nuance in order to penetrate the system and then kind of infest it. I would like to ask my other question, where this is about this Vedic term DamaMukhya, which is also referred in Malayalam as related to Tamasam, where Maharashtra Makhadam, and even in Tamil Mukkadam Mukkadam Akkidar or Mukkadama Mukkandamar. So this is what is their status now? How do they have a continuity? Can you please throw light on this aspect?
This DamaMukhya, or the Pramukh of a residential area, that is Dama means residence. DamaMukhya, and even the word Kavidi, Grahapati, it was Grahapati means literally, though it means the Pati or Lord of the Griha house, it's not so. It also denoted the chief of a residential area. Like that, this DamaMukhya or Mukadama was originally the chief of a residential area, who was the arbitrator, because among the they will settle the disputes among themselves. He was well versed in the among the local habits, local customs, how to partition the property, what are all the peculiar customs and marital rituals and other systems. So he was considered as the parent of society, this DamaMukhya, in the primitive societies. This Vedic word, this DamaMukhya. But gradually, this Mukadama, the word Mukadama, even now it is used as a surname among the Bandaris of Konkan area. And these Bandaris are closely connected with Nadars of Tamil Nadu. So these Nadars, they have a subsect called Mukadamar. And this Mukandamar, they are mentioned as Mukadama, Mukadama Kidar in 17th century inscription, Thiruvarur inscription, it's mentioned as Mukadama Kidar. And 18th century inscription of Udayamartanda Vinayagar at Kulasegrapatnam in Thoothukudi, Tuticorin district, the term Minaikadan Mukandamar, it is mentioned. It sounds like a Tamil word, Minaikadan Mukandamar. But it does not have any meaning. We have to interpret it as Vinaik Idai Mukadama. Because in Sangam literature, Vinai Idai Nindra Sandor. Vinai means any skirmish or any battle. Vinai Idai Nindra Sandor means one who settles disputes, makes peace treaty among both the warring sections. He is called Vinai Idai Nindra Sandro. So Vinaikku Idai Mukadama, that is Minaikadan Mukandamar. Minaikadan, Vinaiked is mentioned even now in colloquial usage as Minaiked. Minaiket means without even after spoiling my own work, I have indulged in this act, but without any fruit, without any utility. That is called Menakkettu Vinadal. So Menakkettudal means Vinaikedu. So here, Vinaikku Idai Mukadama, this arbitrator, that Mukandamar is now a title borne by a subsect of Nadars. And there are inscriptional references also about this Mukandamar. In an 18th century inscription of Sedupadi, Dharma Mukandar is a tobacco field where agricultural activities were conducted and tobacco was grown. It was called Menaikadan, Dharma Mukandar Puhailai Kottam. It is mentioned in the Vaihai copper plate of Sedupadis. So there are many references about Mukandamar, a subsect of Nadars in this. So if we there is another reference. It is mentioned in administration under the Vijayanagar by T.V. Mahalinga. That is, in South India, especially Tamil Nadu, in the 15th century, Vijayanagar Mandaleswaras, they were ruling Tamil Nadu. In the 16th century, beginning of 16th century, they appointed this Palayakarar or Paligar, or even Nayaks, Madura Nayaks. You might have heard about Genji Nayaks and Tanjavur Nayaks. Before that, in the 15th century, they had appointed Mandaleswaras. And these Mandaleswaras, how they governed, administered the area is by appointing Makadams, who ruled over, who administered 10 or 15 villages. And each village had one Ambalakara. So the immediate chief of the village was Ambalakara, and 10 or 15 villages clubbed together, and similar to a taluk, Tahsildar, there was the Makadam, who was in charge of that particular circle or taluk. So it is clear that Makadam or Mukadam, Mukadama, Mukandamar was this title used by an administrator who settles dispute or arbitrator. Even now Marathi people know that Makadam is an arbitrator. And this Bhandari caste people, we have to, if we do research among the Bhandaris, historical claims of Bhandaris, they were very similar to the Nadar Saptam Nadu. So such researchers will throw light upon many castes which are considered as localized. No, it's not so. They are all, they have spread across Indian country.
For the benefit of our audience, I just want to comment that these were to just to highlight or underline the fact that how all these concepts are pan-Indic, and they are not just restricted to a few geographical locations of our country, which in fact the missionaries and the researchers, the evangelical researchers, would like to, the secessionist argument, the people who put secessionist argument would like to make us believe that these are localized things. But your answer clearly establishes the fact, even such nuanced thing like a particular clan name of Mukadama, how so pan-Indic and spread it is, and how even this is reflecting the pan-Indic nature of it. So coming to the question, next question, I would like to ask, which in which you have really done a tremendous work through your book also. So let me read that question. One of the trump cards used by the missionaries as well as other Breaking India forces is that it was the Britishers who had brought social justice to our divided society, which had one section of people so much oppressed that the women in that community were not allowed to wear the upper garment. Okay. So allegedly this kind of oppression was removed by enacting a law, and therefrom justice prevailed. I am referring to this upper cloth revolt. You have looked into the way this Christian missionaries have concocted the original revolt, thereby creating fault lines in Tamil society and exploiting them to their interest. This concoction, their concoction, has been so successful that it has become a pan-Indian lore. I mean, when I talk to some of the North Indian friends, also they even refer to this particular revolt, upper cloth revolt. Can you please throw more light on this upper cloth revolt and how the missionaries had concocted it? Ramachandran.
Certainly. The very term upper cloth revolt was coined by missionaries. It's not a correct term. Actually, to terming it as a revolt, it will be embedded in the psyche of the people. That it, a revolt is, a, for example, revolutionary, revolt. Such words are used for to propagating a view that this society was always based on injustice. So subaltern groups were revolting to claim their rights as human beings. That is what they wanted to project or picturize. And to say some extent they were successful. Because, for example, even now the term survives, upper cloth revolt. Originally the term should be struggle for this restoration or conservation, preservation of the right of wearing the upper cloth. That should be the correct term. Because from the past itself, these people, especially ladies who were called, termed as Shanar ladies, the Sandor must be the correct term. Nadar is only a surname. It's a caste title, not the name of the caste. So I will, let me use the word Shanar. So it is considered as derogatory because they have mentioned the Shanar. Shanar ladies, they were not permitted by the rulers, especially Nayars, who were dominant landholders, who were the administrators, who belonged to the martial race, and who were the rulers of Kerala. They did not permit the downtrodden Shanar ladies to wear the upper cloth. This is total lie. And especially the Christian missionaries, they tried to create this picture that these Shanar ladies were not entitled to wear this upper cloth. It was not so. Originally, the thing, it was a clash of consciousness. The Nadar or Shanar people, they belonged to the Chera dynasty or Chera royal house. After the 12th century, that is around 1114, the last Chairman Perumal, he went as an ascetic. He renounced the world. And before that, he gave his daughter in marriage to Perumbadappu Illam Nambudri and with an assurance that their offspring will become the Kshatriya, Kochi Kshatriya. That's this has been recorded by historians. Though it is not an exact truth, it has some major element of truth in that. By this way, the entire Kerala became a Parasurama Kshetra, where Brahmins became the rulers. It may be true. No, I am not denying the fact that the Kerala, after 12th century, it became a Parasurama Kshetra, where Nambudri's writ ran large. but how and why the original people belong to the Chera lineage? They migrated to either towards the east, Coimbatore district, that is adjacent to Palghat district, and down south, Kanyakumari district. This Kanyakumari district formed part of this Travancore state up to 1956, only due to reorganization of states on linguistic basis, it was merged. Kanyakumari district was merged into Madras state and later became Tamil Nadu. But before that, it formed part of Travancore state. The Travancore king and all other military people, they were all Nayars. But in the 17th and 18th century, these people, Nadar people, Shanar peoples were at the receiving end. It is true. But at the same time, there were also some Turakara means who were looking after administration, the provinces. There were some Turakara Nadars, Shanars were also there. But comparatively speaking, Nadars were at the receiving end. They were there was some downward mobility. Nayars were in the upward mobility mode. So gradually, when Britishers entered into the field, around 1780, Tipu threatened invasion of Travancore area. And British East India Company entered into the scene. They assured the king, the chief of Travancore, to assist him. And by to thwart the invasion of Tipu. And near in the year 1790s, Tipu invaded Travancore. At the same, his invasion was thwarted. He was defeated. He was sent back to his Srirangapatna. But due to that assistance, they placed one resident to govern the area. He was called Mekale. And he demanded many dues for example, per year, 3,500 star pagodas initially. Then later, he demanded arrears also. And he disbanded the Nayar regiment and placed the Madras regiment there. Gradually, the Nayar's people were going down in the social scale. And there was Protestant missionary activity supported by the Britishers, British administration. And then particularly one resident after Mekale, one John Munro, he completely dismantled the Vritti lands. Vritti lands means that's like endowments. Lands endowed to Brahmins, temples and other such. The temples were administered by Nayars. So the Nayars who were leaseholders of the lands, they were also affected. And gradually, many Nayars were, due to the disbandment of this regiment, they become, they had no work to do. So in the social scale also, they were going down. And suddenly John Munro, claiming that arrears of due to 18 lakhs of rupees have to be paid as dues from the government, he abolished the endowments, and then he ordered that all tax to be paid as agriculture tax, Thirvai, has to be paid in cash, not in kind. So these leaseholders who were looking after their lands, cultivable lands, they have to, after the harvest, they have to sell the product. They sell especially rice, paddy in the market and make it into cash and then convert into cash and then remit the amount. They found it very difficult because they were, had no experience in trade. And all the traders were sanars, nadars. So they thought their pent-up anger was diverted against the sanars. And previous to this, when Veluthambi Thalavai was Diwan, after him, the post of Diwan was also abolished. But resident became the Diwan also. But during this Veluthambi's revolt against the Britishers, some Nadars, Sanars were also, royal herders were also joined hands with them. But now, the Nadar traders, gradually they were in the society, social scale, they were moving upward. And the economical status also, they were gaining. From adjoining Tirunelveli and Tuticorin districts, many Nadar traders who grew tobacco, they were involved in trading tobacco. So gradually they encroached the market forces also. So these Nayars, they have to sell the paddy in a reduced price and then remit a higher amount in the treasury as tax. So such things were building up. Simultaneously, religious conversion also was taking place. And in 1 year, the city magistrate, who was one Charles Mead, he converted 3,000 Nadars in a single year. He was a judge, magistrate. So this open connivance with the missionaries, the colonial administration was acting in such a manner. So this pent-up anger of Nayar people, it was gradually turning into a rage, and suddenly it erupted as the humiliating the Shanar ladies in public. Some of the Shanar ladies who covered their breast with blouse and then upper cloth. Upper cloth was already worn by all the Shanar ladies. Nayar ladies were not accustomed to the habit of wearing upper cloth because they did not consider this as they will wear mundu. And whenever they come across any foreigner or any Muslim like that, they will cover their breasts. Otherwise, they won't cover their breasts. So these Nadar Shanar people, they will degradingly ask, call them as Mangalanan Ariyada Mandai Sandai Makkal. Because the Nadar, the Nayar custom of marriage was not, there was no Mangalya Sutra, Thali was not tied around the bride's neck. The bridegroom will give a white colored silk sari to the bride. The bride will accept that the marital ceremony is over. This is called Pudavai Kodai in among Nayars. The marriage is called Pudavai Kodai, simply gift of sari. So they were not accustomed to the adorning their neck with the thali. So this is also, they pointed out this fact. Mangalanan Ariyada Mandai Sadnai Makkal. These people are herd. They are behaving like a herd, these Nayars. They don't know the auspiciousness of the thali, Mangali Sutra. So such things both became severe opponents, and both of them were some of the Christian converts, sonars, they thought that their duty to this government, usually paid in the form of labor, need not be paid now onwards because they have been liberated from Hinduism and they have joined Christianity. And there was a proclamation also, Nadar converts need not pay the Uliyam. Uliyam means a tax in the form of labor. They need not do that. There was a proclamation by the resident. So such things went to the boiling point, and it erupted as the humiliation of Sanar ladies by tearing the blouses and humiliating them by removing the upper cloth. So they resisted, and especially one thing we have to, two things we have to notice. One is Ayya Vaikundar, who was a reformist among Sanar community people. he clearly says that போட்டிருந்த தோல் சிலை போடாதே என்று சொன்னார். தட் இஸ் தி நாயர்ஸ் ஆர் தி ரூலர்ஸ் தே த்ரிட்டன்ட் வார்ன்ட் தி சனார் பீப்புள் டோன்ட் யூஸ் யுவர் ட்ரெடிஷனல் ட்ரெஸ்ஸிங் மோட் போட்டிருந்த தோல் சிலை போடாதே என்று சொன்னார். நவ் ஆன் பேர்ட்ஸ் யூ ஹவ் நோ ரைட் டு கவர் யுவர் பிரஸ்ட்ஸ். ஸோ இட் இஸ் கிளியர்லி மென்ஷன்ட் இன் ஆல் சச் லிட்ரரி ரெஃபரன்சஸ் தட் சனார் பீப்புள் were accustomed to wearing this upper cloth. It was their usual mode of dress. Nair ladies had did not pretend to be very particular about this type of dress. They were not particular that to cover their breasts among themselves. Whenever a foreigner or a Muslim or such people, they have to come across, they will cover their breast. So this is the clash of consciousness, and it erupted in such a manner. And there is another reference. It was a very particular reference. In the year 1859, the resident, with the advice of the resident, the king proclaimed, he issued a proclamation that hereafter, Chanar ladies can wear the upper cloth. They should not be molested. Prior to that, on the day of 7th February 1859, the resident was one Mr. Lieutenant Colonel Cullen. 6 London missionaries have submitted a petition to him. In that petition, 8th point is very significant. They have openly accepted that the system of upper cloth did not find its origin among the Protestant missionary. It was going on for centuries. It was the original practice, but that not a Shanar ladies of all subsects or all social status, they were wearing this upper cloth as a traditional mode of dressing. We did not entertain into that. We have no connection with that manner, with that particular matter. All Shanar ladies were, before the advent of introduction of Protestant, wearing this. So it does not find its origin among the Protestants or missionaries. That is what they have particularly mentioned in the 8th point in that petition. So it is clear that it was not an upper cloth revolt. It was a struggle for the preserving the rights of the wearing the upper cloth. That's all. It was a clash of consciousness, and there were many points, many economical, socio-economical problems, pent up anger against which could not be directed against the government because they had the fear that it will be, the punishment will be very severe. So their anger was directed towards the weaker section of the weaker sex ladies, particularly Sanar ladies. That is the main point we want to not only insist, we want to clearly prove that it was not an upper cloth revolt. Missionaries played a very subtle and major role in instigating the clashes with the connivance of the resident. And what they gained means many of the Sanar people, they converted to Christianity. That was their main aim, and particularly why they chose Sanar people, you know, they understood, because they were they had such an administrative talent that Sanar people will be not only obedient, they will grasp any subject, and they behave in an organized and disciplined manner. They were not, they understood that they were not downtrodden. For centuries, they were not slaves. They understood that these are the soft targets to convert. That's why they created this problem and propagated like as it is a really upper cloth revolt. That was the agenda, in the agenda of the Protestant Lutheran missionaries. And one thing we have to, this London Mission Society was very notorious. This London Mission Society was there. All the 6 missionaries belong to the London Mission Society. The Charles Mead, he was a magistrate. He was a member of the London Mission Society. And this London Mission Society was very active in slave trade in South Africa. After slavery was abolished in 1845, you know, the London Mission Society, they transported many people as indentured laborers. Even Mahatma Gandhi, you know, in Transvaal and Natal, he fought in the legal field also. He fought against the terming these indentured laborers as not belonging to a family, because only when the marriage is baptized, that is, marriage is solemnized in the church, it will be considered as a family, or an inheritance will be allowed. Otherwise, a son or daughter born, a child born to this couple, he will also become an indentured laborer. So this injustice, Gandhi was particular about opposing it through organizing protests. And you know, Thillaiyadivalliyammai and Nagappan, they are all involved in that protest march, and they were herded into a prison. And in the unhygiene, due to unhygienic conditions, Thillaiyadivalliyammai, and they died, pathetically died. So you know, this London Mission Society was very active in the slave trade. Even after slavery was abolished, this same London Mission Society, who preached that they were concerned about all such downtrodden people, they were concerned about social justice, everything. They blabbered like anything, but they were the main culprits in indulging in slave trade. After the abolition of slave trade, they were the exporters of indentured laborers to South Africa. That we have to understand.
Thank you very much, Ramachandran ji. This elaborate explanation for how the upper cloth revolt was actually concocted. In fact, your response has also highlighted the fact that we have to look at history in a very nuanced manner, in a very holistic manner, and not just go by what is being presented to us. Because I am very sure that not many people are aware about this kind of a long established struggle about this upper cloth thing. And it's not just that one fine day the Britishers or the missionaries came and they kind of relieved these oppressive people. The popular narrative that is being commonly told, and what the naive people normally believe. So it is this centuries of struggle that has happened between two clans. As you rightly put, it is the clash of consciousness, which is what is the background for this kind of the revolt that you have presented. I think we are already crossing the time, so we will have you more on the Atharva forum for more topics to discuss further. As it is said, like this quote by Peter Drucker, and the famous quote goes that culture eats strategy for breakfast. So all these missionary people, they had the proper strategy. It is now for us to look at them, understand them through brilliant expositions by people like you, through your books. We have to understand these in a much more nuanced way. The sinister role that these missionaries have played in fracturing our society. I thank you very much, Ramachandran ji, for your time and effort. And I also thank Atharva Forum for this beautiful opportunity. Thank you very much, Ramachandran.
Thank you for giving me an opportunity to elaborately discuss and then putting forth my viewpoint. Thank you, sir.
Namaste, sir.